And we have to thank Autism Awareness Australia and especially Nick Rogerson for bringing us in here. And it's
our newest hero.
Yeah. And I want to advise you of two things. One is that we do not have a slideshow. That's going to be up there the entire time. We were gambling that if it just stared at you the whole time, you would be left with a compulsion to read the book. So that's what we're working on. The other thing I want to tell you, Caren and I spent 7 years working on that book. We did a very, very exhaustive exploration of the backstory of autism. And it took much longer than we expected. But I want to warn you that when two people have been working together for 7 years, you're going to find that they have a tendency to
finish each other's sentences.
And it begins.
Usually I annoy him in the process of doing that. What we haven't, you might have not heard about us, is that John and I covered autism together for almost 20 years. And we've been telling the stories, not just in our book, but through our work, for years about autism and about people with autism. And tonight, we want to go a different route. We want to talk about people outside of the autism community who have a vital role in changing the lives of people who have autism. So that's going to be our focus this evening.
Yeah, we refer to people who don't have a connection to autism. And by connection to autism, I mean either you're on the spectrum or you have a loved one on the spectrum or you are a professional working with somebody on the spectrum. If you're not one of those people, we call you a civilian.
It's the nicest word we could think of.
Our goal was to get civilians to understand the experience of people on the spectrum by knowing what their amazing, compelling, and unfortunately often disturbing backstory was, and to get the civilians to recognize that the way they decide, and because it's a choice, it's ultimately a choice, the way they decide to respond to people on the spectrum has an enormous impact on the quality of life that people on the spectrum can have. If they accept them into their communities, embrace them, make friends with them, welcome them to their workplaces and to their schools, the people on the spectrum have the much better shot at richer lives, and the civilians come out of it better as well. But unfortunately, and the story of autism tells us that for a lot of the time and for many decades and in a lot of places, that wasn't the case. And in the end of our book, we actually tell a little story that illustrates this in the present day. And it's a little scene that took place on a public bus in New Jersey, regular city bus in New Jersey in the year 2007. And on that bus, there was a young man named Nicholas. And Nicholas was quite impaired by his autism. He was unable to speak, and he was a very, very slow learner. But he had been getting lessons on a daily basis in how to ride the bus, how to use public transportation. The kind of lesson which, if he could master it, would so open his world and give him a key to independence that he could go out and get around on his own. But it was a very slow process for him, and so for day after day, week after week, he was riding back and forth on the same bus route with a teacher who was teaching him using behavioral approach, step by step, how it worked, how to get to the bus stop, how to recognize the bus, how to signal for the bus, how to stop the bus, how to get on the bus, how to pay your ticket, how to find your seat, how to find your stop, every little step along the way. And it was going well. And same time every day as it happened, for the most part, the same group of passengers as happens in life, the same time of day takes the bus back and forth on the same route. So people saw what was going on. Over time, he was making so much progress that the teacher had begun to move away and was fading towards the back of the bus and just kind of keeping an eye on things. So one day, the bus comes to a stop. Nicholas is on it. He's sitting alone on a seat near the front. And two guys get on the bus who had not regulars on the route. Two guys get on the bus. And they sit down behind Nicholas, and the bus starts to move. And as the bus starts to move, Nicholas begins to rock back and forth in his seat quite visibly, and he begins flipping his fingers in front of his eyes. He's stimming. And then he begins to vocalize. And I say vocalize because, again, he didn't have words, but he was making sounds. And the two guys behind him get very annoyed by this. And they lean into him, and they begin to harass him, basically to bully him. And they say to him, "Hey man, what, you know, cut that out. What's wrong with you anyway?" And that kind of example, taken from just 2007, kind of typifies the challenge of needing the larger world, the community, the civilians to get it, to understand the damage that they could do in that moment to the project that he was engaged in, If this threw him off, and in fact it did throw him off that day, to undo all of the work that he had done, this shot at independence, is such a profound impact. And if those guys had gone the other way, it could have been such a better outcome. And in looking at the history also, there were just so many examples going back decades of the ways in which society failed people on the spectrum.
They institutionalized people. If you had a child with a developmental disability or autism later on, as we know it today, you were put in an institution, and as parents, you were told to forget you ever had that child and just move on with your lives. Children with autism, the law said, we don't have to take you. You don't belong here. And it wasn't until advocacy and parents went out there and fought for those children that didn't have voices to fight for themselves. Today there are self-advocates. There are people like Chris who can go out there and speak to all of us about their experiences and what it's like. But for many people, even still today, who don't have the voice to speak for themselves, their parents have been advocating for them for years.
But the battle that the parents fought in the beginning, and by the beginning, we're talking about the 1950s, the 1960s, the 1970s, because the diagnosis only came into focus in the 1940s. The battle that the parents had was complicated by the fact that the profession of psychiatry had decided by the mid-1950s that they knew what caused autism. What caused autism was mothers.
Me. It was my fault. So I didn't just have a child with autism. I caused it.
And the theory was, it was called the refrigerator mother theory, and it was the theory that absolutely, if you go back and find a book from the 1950s, a psychology, psychiatry textbook about autism, it would tell you that children had autism because their mothers had failed to love them sufficiently in the first weeks of their lives, and that the child's autism was a decision by the child to withdraw into his or her own world to protect himself. So it was a defense mechanism. And this thing was so invidious that when mothers would go to psychiatrists for help, they were how can I help my child? The mother was told, you, mom, need to get into psychotherapy immediately to figure out what you did wrong.
But there's a great story about the first person ever diagnosed with autism and how their family and how the community changed this person's life.
So that's where the hope comes from this era. So as Caren mentioned, things have changed to such a degree that the things we're talking about are unrecognizable now, the institutionalization, the lack of access to education, the mother blaming, because parents fought back. That's a positive, very positive part of the story. But as Caren said, there's also this beautiful story that we discovered about the first child ever diagnosed. And what do we mean by the first child ever diagnosed? Well, in 1943, it was really the first time that autism was described in the medical literature. And child psychiatrist in Baltimore, Maryland, published an article in which he said, I've been treating 11 children over the last few years. And there's something about them. And they'd all come to him with parents who didn't understand why their children were different in the way they were different. And they had all been given other diagnoses. They were literally called, the diagnosis was idiocy, in some cases was the word used, feeble-mindedness, some schizophrenia, childhood schizophrenia. And he said, there's something else going on here and it needs its own name. And so he wrote an article describing for the first time this syndrome that he referred to by the adjective autistic. And the very first child that he described, and the one that always really captured his attention, he described in great detail over many pages. And his name was Donald. And his last name wasn't given, just the initial of his last name, Donald T. And the story in the literature sorry? Oh!
No, that's
wait,
so
wait, wait,
not
wait.
The way
Donald
we're going with
Trump.
That.
I'm not familiar.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Oh, right, that guy.
Yeah.
But this was the good Donald. And this Donald, set out to find because we knew we needed to tell his story. And John and I, both as researchers and determined to tell the story, in order to tell the story of autism, we had to find the first person ever diagnosed. And we knew that his last name started with a T. We had learned from research and information that he was from Forest, Mississippi.
Which is a little town of 3,000 people in the middle of a state.
Not far from Jackson,
yeah.
Right? And so John and I both sort of set out to try to track down Donald. And And John got on the internet, and I took out the white pages, and I was calling every T from Forest, Mississippi. And one day John said to me, oh, no, I think I found this on the internet, because I don't do internet back then. And try this number, and I call this number in Forest, Mississippi, and all of a sudden an answering machine picks up. And on the other end of the answering machine, I hear this voice that says, hello, happy spring, and have a wonderful fall, and a spectacular Christmas. Happy 2007. And I hang up and I call him. That's it, we found him. I know this is Donald. I mean, I have a child with autism. I know that voice. I've heard it before.
So what we knew is that we were dealing with a man who was in his 70s by this time, because we had calculated from the story in the medical journal. We didn't know very much about what his situation was, and he had been living in privacy all this time, so we didn't want to directly just knock on his door. So we tried to find people who might be in his circle, called relatives, called people we thought might be his friends, and we introduced ourselves to them and said, we're coming from up north, and we're a couple of journalists, and we'd like to meet Donald, and here's why. Would you please introduce us, check us, ask him if he would talk with us, and if the answer is no, we'll go away. We really meant it.
But normally, journalists just go and knock on the door, and, you know, we just show up on your doorstep.
But we're special.
Right.
So
we're from the autism world, so we were being polite, and the reaction we got to us being polite was, okay, we will introduce you to Donald, but if you mess with him in any way, we will hunt you down and we will get you. And they weren't kidding. This immediately put us on alert that this was a community that cared about this person and was protective of this community, protective of Donald, and we knew right away that there was a community of people that weren't going to let us touch this guy, and it was something we had never seen before.
So we went in to explore whatever happened to Donald, and so to go back to his childhood, very briefly, what had happened was that he was a little boy born in 1933, a little boy in 1938 when his parents took him to Baltimore to see this child psychiatrist. But before they took him there, they had put him in an institution. They'd sent him away as a 2.5-year-old child.
But that's what everyone did then.
The pressure that was put on families, you know, people now say, how could parents do that? The pressure put on families to do that because of the stigma and the shame, and also the perception that it was useless to keep a child like that at home. People would be told routinely, don't take that burden on your family. Take care of your quote-unquote normal kids, give them everything you have, put the resources where they're worth it, let the state take care of it. But they did that for a year, and then they pulled him out, and they got this diagnosis, and they brought him home, and they had some clout in this little town. They were well-educated, and the mom's family owned the bank, so they had some money, and they pulled him out, and they more or less announced to the town, our son Donald belongs in this home and he belongs in this town, and that's the signal that we're sending. And the mom went down to the school. She had no legal right to have her son educated. She talked the school into having him go to school. He went to school. He made friends. The kids in the school grew up through the 1930s and the 1940s, getting to know him, getting not only to know him, but actually getting to appreciate him. And the story I know you're dying to jump in here. Yeah, you're being very polite. Should I stop talking?
No, go ahead.
Sure,
one more minute.
Okay. So the story was, what happened was, what we discovered was when we went down there and talked to all of these people who had known Donald all these decades, who were now in their 70s and their 80s, they all said, well, you know, he's just a great guy. And he's a genius. He's a math genius. That was the other story.
Well, so the other thing is that it doesn't hurt when you're, and so not to make it that this, that Forest was a miracle place, because it didn't hurt that his parents owned the local bank. And if you wanted to get a loan or anything, you had to go through them. But what made the biggest difference was Donald and the way the children growing up around him saw him. He used to walk over, we believe that his peers thought that he was somewhat of a genius. He used to walk around town, and he used to like write numbers in the air and do math problems, and he used to count
the license plates. Yeah, he would walk around the town square and memorize the license plates of every car in town, and so he could command those numbers. And then he had this really interesting, quirky thing he did.
He gave everybody numbers. And we met all of these people. And from like 60, 70 years ago, we'd meet someone and what was her name? Janelle?
Janelle Brown.
Right. Yeah. You know, she'd say, I'm number 432. And you'd ask Donald, and he'd say, you know, 432.
So, but what he would say, we would say, how did you get this number? How did you get your number from Donald? How did he assign you a number? And she said, I was in high school one day, I was a sophomore, and he walked up to me and he said, Janelle Brown, from now on, your number is 432. And then he turned and walked away.
And we learned that at the beginning it was mostly girls. So this was his way, right? But he did have some guy friends that had numbers, the football players. And in fact, we have one. I'm 549 and John's 550, and that's because I'm so much younger. Well, that's at least what I think. So Donald was a number guy. And there's this story.
Before you get to that story, let's just tell people how Donald's life has turned out.
Okay.
Do you think we should do that? Donald's life has turned out amazingly well. He was echolalic, like purely echolalic as a little boy.
He had classic autism.
Well, he's the template for the diagnosis of autism.
But you meet him today, and he's totally different. Now, it doesn't mean that he doesn't have autism. He clearly has autism, and if you met him and you knew him and you tried to have a conversation, you would see that he is still different. But difference, okay. But different included him traveling all over the world.
That's what he does. That's his hobby.
And playing golf.
And driving a car. He drives a Cadillac.
And he learned how to do that at 27 when his mother taught him. It's so much like me and my kid. It's just, the mothers have to teach their children how to do things,
and
right?
And he's got friends. He has real friends. He socializes all the time. People look out for him all the time. They help him go shopping because he has a habit of wearing the same clothes actually many days in a row, and it gets tattered, and they'll say, why don't we go shopping together? If they
or
see
you need to change his shirt. It's a little smelly. I mean, they really do watch out for him, and they have for his entire life.
And not in a patronizing way. They call him, it's not as though they're, he's the town, it's not like he's a mascot or something like that. That they just call him a friend.
There's someone
they call him a great guy.
They care about, and he has taught them about perseverance. He has taught them about what it means to be a good human being, just by being his friend. And now, can I tell that story?
You can tell that story.
Okay. So
because it's part of the legend of Donald.
Right. So when we first went to Forest, one of the things that a lot of the townspeople asked us, did you hear the brick story? And we'd be, what's the brick story? You have to know the brick story, right? You know the story about Donald and the bricks. And we're like, no, we don't know the story about Donald and the bricks.
So this is the story that's the foundational story of Donald's mathematical genius. That
legendary.
Everybody told us.
Okay, in Jackson, Mississippi, which is like 40 miles away from Forest, they're talking about the brick story. So if you were part of Forest, you knew the brick story.
So the brick story is that one day when Donald was in high school, and he hit all of his milestones late. So he was in high school at the age of about 20 or 21. And one day when he was a sophomore, second year, he stepped out of the building, the high school building. The building's gone now, but we found archival photographs of it. And it was this big, massive red brick building, one side with almost no windows, just almost solid bricks, two stories high, down a whole street. He steps out through the doorway, and he's surrounded by a group of boys. And they say, hey, Donald, you're so good with numbers. Why don't you tell us how many bricks are in the side of that building there behind you? And the story goes that he turned around, and he looked at it for about a second, and then he turns back to the boys, and he threw out the number. And their jaws just dropped, and they ran off, and they began to spread the legend of Donald Triplett's, incredible gift, mathematical gift, perceptive gifts, everything else, to the point where decades later, everybody wanted us to know the story of what a brilliant guy this, when we got there, the townspeople never knew that he was the first child diagnosed with autism. We delivered that news. But this guy was the genius of the town.
So we've become very close with the Triplett family. We've been covering Donald's story for years. We've gone back and forth to Forest for many years. And we know Donald and the family quite well. And so I said to Donald, how did you do it? Like, how did you figure out how many bricks there were. Like, you know, how did you put that all together? And he looked at me and he said, I didn't. I made it up. Okay. So I'm obviously perplexed, and I, you know, said, so why did you do that? And he said, I wanted the boys to like me. So anybody who says anything about people with autism not having compassion, empathy, not wanting to connect to people, not caring about anything, everything in that one statement tells you how wrong they are. That people with autism want to be loved, want to be connected, just as much as any one of us.
We want the world to know the story of what happened in Forest. Not the Donald part so much. We want them to know about that community and how that community stepped up and did the right thing. And last year, after our book came out, we had vague plans of making a documentary based on the book. And we were dawdling. And we got a phone call.
That's why it only took us 7 years to write the book.
Yes, we dawdle a lot. We got a phone call. Caren got the phone call from Donald's brother to tell her that Donald was dying. He had some intestinal bleeding.
He had an ulcer and it was bleeding and all these complications, and his brother Oliver basically said, "Listen, he's lived a great life. He's a good man. He's been an example to all of us." And you know, I mean, Oliver was sort of resigned that he was going to lose his brother, except that Donald wasn't going anywhere. Luckily for us and everybody else, because he rallied and got out of intensive care, and within 3 months was back on the golf course, which is something he loves to do. And we thought, okay, we need to get down there now, because we want to tell his story. We want to have his story for other people to be able to see for themselves the kind of man that who the very first child with autism, what that man turned out to be and who he is at 83 years old.
And what role his community had to play in it. Because what we'd like to say is, if we could bottle the thing that happened in Forest and spread it around the world and get communities, you know, we talk so much about people on the spectrum having to change and grow, and you know, it's the communities around them need to change.
It wasn't just Donald. It was everyone around him, we believe, that made Donald's life so good. It was the support and the community and the friendship that gave him the support to be the man that he became.
Now, can other communities get the lesson of Forest? We think so. Now, that story I told you about the bus in New Jersey, where that young man named Nicholas was sitting alone on the front seat, making those sounds and flipping his fingers, dimming and rocking back and forth, and these two bullies get on and sit down behind him, and they say to him, you know, what's wrong with you anyway? Stop doing that.
And all of a sudden, this other guy on the bus jumps up and says, hey, he's got autism. What's your problem? You know, why don't you, I'm going to say bug off.
You were. We are streaming live.
Why don't you back off? And at that moment, the entire bus became a community. And everyone on that bus, other than the two guys who were bullying Nicholas, became a community that was protecting him. And it was that simple that Nicholas ran back, was on the bus riding back and forth and back and forth, and the same people on the bus were riding the bus every day. And at that moment, they became a community that protected this young man with autism.
Because we don't think it's really that hard to have the back of somebody who's different. We think that if people, civilians, hear the stories, know the stories, that almost everybody wants to do the right thing. They just need to have a little bit of information. That's why we wrote the book, and it's
why we're doing a movie now.
We're making the movie.
And the other reason we're making a movie is because we feel that the book, even though it tells all these wonderful stories about the history of autism, and it's through the people who've lived the stories, whose history it is, it's hard to get the civilians to read. It's a big book, actually. And when it was in hardcover, it looked like a doorstop. It looks much better now. And see there? And so it's a scary book to read, but a movie is much, much much more palatable to people outside of the community. And we really believe that this film has the potential to teach everybody outside of the autism community what how easy it is to have the back of somebody who's different.
But don't be that scared by the book. Stare at that image while we take questions. Thank you very much.